Okay, it's my great pleasure to introduce Dana Peer, our next speaker. So Dana is currently the chair of the Computational and Systems Biology Program and scientific director of the Ellen and Sandra Gary Metastasis and Tumor Ecosystem Center at the Sloan Kettering Institute. Dana has actually obtained a PhD in computer science at the Hebrew University in Jerusalem, spent some time as a postdoc with George Church at Harvard, and then has acquired a number of important grants and prizes, including, for example, the ISMB Overton Prize and the Ernst Bertner Memorial Award from the University of Texas MD Anderson Cancer Center, and many others. She has a number of roles that I will not list, and of course you will hear more about the work, but she has over the years made a lot of important contributions to the analysis of gene regulatory systems, in particular in cancer, and in recent years she does a lot of this in single cells, and I'm pretty sure that we will hear some of this from her today. Thank you very much for agreeing to speak, Dana, and we look forward to your presentation.
For you guys today, I decided rather than, you know, give you a big grand talk of everything and everything and everything one can do, I decided, since this is sort of a computational workshop, to take a deep dive into what I find my favorite thing about single cell data. So let me try and share my screen and hope it works this time. And basically talk about, you know, trajectories in single cell data and what you can do with them. And really the reason I fell in love with single cell data, and as Niko said, most of my work, and in fact almost like 99% of my work is single cell data. What caused me to fall in love with single cell data is the fact that this data is asynchronous in nature. If you take a piece of bone marrow, if you take a sample of bone marrow out of a human being, then what you have is not one cell type, not one cell state, but what you really have there is really a synchronous mix of cells, everything from the hematopoietic stem cells, all through the different more mature hematopoietic lineages and everything in between. And this asynchrony, really, even a cell line, for example, hit with TGF-beta to induce the epithelial to mesenchymal transition, you know, you take any day in this time course, and while on average you see the progression from epithelial to mesenchymal, here, if you see my pointer, you see in a single time point, epithelial cells, mesenchymal cells, and the transitioning cells, as well as all the rise and fall of different transcription factor and chromatin regulators of this critical transition. So you can really get dynamics and even infer regulatory networks using temporal principles from a single cell, single sample, due to this beautiful asynchrony and the temporal trajectories you can find in such data. We first noticed the sort of trajectory nature of data and development about a decade ago. This was when we were first developing CyTOF with Gary Nolan, and at the time everyone was basically clustering, and cell types were these discrete entities. And we saw for B cells that when you do the standard gates that immunologists do to sort of say this is this type of B cell and this is that type of B cell, you actually chuck 60% of the data into the garbage. So the standard gates that we've been looking at in immunology, you know, prior to single cell studies, really missed 60% of the cells, the transitioning cells. And then we noticed that actually the first principal component really roughly follows trends that you see in B cell development. You know, we knew which markers and genes, proteins go up and down in B cell development, and just taking the first principal component got a good first approximation of this. Now, it was a good first approximation for a little piece of it, but it actually principal component analysis was really crappy for this data. And this is a T-SNE projection of single cell data, where each dot is an individual cell, sort of mapped to 3D in a way that best preserves the distances between these cells in high dimensions. And these green cells are developing B cells. The light cells are early stage B cells. The dark cells are late stage. And this orange line really describes the progression, the maturity of these B cells. And what you could see is that it twists and turns in high dimensional space. And looking at a, you know, at a biaxial plot of just two markers, you see that, you know, one marker rises and then falls and another marker goes up. So, you know, two points can seem very similar to each other in high dimensional space and linear space, but, you know, are actually very, very distant in the manifold space, in the space where cell phenotypes exist and the space that cells can actually biologically traverse. And this really is the reason why all the methods we use for single cell data analysis are nonlinear in their nature. And we try and actually find these high dimensional manifolds, these regions in which cell phenotypes exist. Now, nonlinear methods inherently and density estimation and everything, like if you try and directly try and find cell densities in high dimensional space, that will miserably fail because any attempt to do things such as density estimation in high dimensional space suffers from heavy computational and heavy statistical robustness faults. And generally nonlinear approaches for the most part are not very robust. But one really, really robust sort of hammer that's really central to most single cell data analysis, certainly any single cell data analysis that's not deep learning based, and deep learning has its own problems, which I could go into, is the nearest neighbor graph. This is the central entity in the majority of single cell algorithms today, where each node is a cell, and then you connect each cell to its most similar cells based on their expression. So you define some metric, and the devil's in the details for different types of data and biological questions. You define a slightly different metric, and you connect each cell to a small number of its very, very similar cells. And you assume that if you're taking a small step in graph, if you're taking steps between similar cells, you're still within the data manifold. You're still within cell type, cell states that exist and are possible in biology. And rather than, you know, taking big Euclidean distances between distant cells, you measure distances in the space as walks in the graph and how long each walk is. Of course, this graph is weighted based on distances, and there's a, you know, there's a lot of details in how you construct this graph, and each type of application and question and nuanced data set requires a different graph construction. But the basic idea of constructing a nearest neighbor graph where the nodes are cells connected to their sort of most similar cells really sort of like constructs a mesh on this high dimensional geometry, and we really, really learn the global structure of cell phenotypic space via small steps. Of course, this is really amenable to look for trajectories. I mean, you can actually find a trajectory, and actually a walk along this graph finds a trajectory. If we take, you know, the average of many, many, many walks, we could see what are the common dominant trajectories in the data. Again, of course, the devil is in the detail. We first, you know, did this with our Wunderlist algorithm. And again, there are so many pseudo-time methods out there. There's well over 100. There, you know, this is such a strong signal in the data. As I've shown you, the first principal component really gets you something that's not too bad. The trick here is to get something that's reproducible and that could pick up these rare cells. There's generally in biology, it's very, very easy to sort of pick up the average behavior. But in biology, stem cells, certain cell populations, often rare cells are the most important cells. And here, a lot of computational methods fail. So we had to put a lot of efforts to build a method that would be really, really accurate and be able to capture rare cells. In our method, we were able to capture these rare cells sort of cartooned in orange right here. Populate what we called population 3. This was a previously uncharacterized early population of B cell development. It's only 7 in 10,000 cells, so really, really tiny, which showed you just how accurate you had to be to get it. And this rare population is, you know, it has a lot of different stuff going on. This is where the VDJ recombination happens. This is where the genome shuffles to get the individual BCR. This rare population has a completely different rewired signaling. It's a checkpoint to make sure that that this recombination, I mean, if you're going to break apart and shuffle your DNA, you certainly want to have a checkpoint after that, that that was successful. This checkpoint, this signaling is active only in these 7 in 10,000 cells. Cells that are a bit earlier or a bit later no longer have this checkpoint. And now that we could characterize healthy so well and so deeply and so accurately, including these very rare populations, we could sort of pinpoint and say that these are the rare populations that are actually the cells of origin of pediatric acute lymphoblastic leukemia. And, you know, the cell of origin wasn't found because the healthy cell wasn't identified until we could really get a good trajectory. By the way, this population was typically removed by the typical gates that people used when they were studying before. That was sort of the beginning. Now I want to take you fast forward quite a few years. So let's fast forward 5-6 years to work. And now I'm going to tell you a lot of work by Manu Seti, who just started his own lab at Fretch Hutch. But he did a lot of really great trajectory work in my lab. And again, from a single linear, or not linear, but from a single one-dimensional trajectory, we wanted branching trajectories. We wanted to study cell fate decisions. And again, for a very long time, I was trying to, you know, find the branching point and pinpoint the branching point so I could see what happens right before the branching point and right after the branching point to understand cell fate decisions. And this is the point where you realize that you've defined the biological question wrong. And we were bashing our heads and, you know, we developed some algorithms that were sort of okay, but we could never really pinpoint the branching point. And looking at the data, we realized that we were asking the wrong question. There is no branching point, but rather there are branching planes and the decision is a gradual and probabilistic one. And just like cell states are gradual and change gradually, you know, a transcription factor or a gene doesn't just turn on and off, transcription, translation, all that takes time. Also, decision isn't made at a point, but it's a gradual decision where you're more likely to be one fate or another with gradually changing probabilities. Realizing that, we wanted to develop a model that captures these gradual probabilities, treating cell fate also as a continuous probability rather than a discrete binary point of choice. And we took the graph, the basic graph that sort of underlies everything, and, you know, development goes from, you know, the earlier cell to the later cell. We want to see what the future cell fates are. So we have to figure out a way to sort of direct this graph, and pseudotime is a wonderful way to do that. And then once we have a directed graph, we can bring, you know, the full rich tools of Markov chains. Markov chains is just a rich mathematical theory with so many methods and approaches and math that allows you to do really, really powerful computations on this graph. And that's what we did. So, you know, and again, I want to again stress that when we're developing our methods, since all the critical things happen in rare populations, a lot of times when you're developing an algorithm, you sort of say, how is my average behavior? And, you know, your average behavior, you can get methods that will score really well on the boring, large, nothing's happening there, average populations. But if you care about rare cells, you have to make extra efforts in your methods development. And again, you have a cell manifold. On the cell manifold, there are very different cell densities, and you need to be able to sample this manifold, again, for computational efficiency, in a way that also samples the rare populations, which have low density. So we developed a sampling approach, which is, again, often used in many different single-cell algorithms, even though it was first presented in Palantir, to really sample in a manner that covers the whole manifold and basically says, oh, this is a region where I've already covered it. It's very dense. I already have cells from this region. Let me go look and sample from regions that I haven't covered to really cover the entire manifold. And again, these details really, really matter. The concept, that cartoon of the algorithm is great, but then it's the fine details that are the difference between a strong method and a robust method, and the method that just isn't going to get you the novel biology. Now, again, once I have this graph, I can take this graph and transition it to a matrix. Now, you know, I want to compute the probability of walks on the graph. That, you know, if I want to compute the probability of millions of walks, hundreds of millions of walks, you know, that could be hairy. Except, again, I told you Markov theory is so wonderful. Once I, you know, translate this graph into a matrix, then, you know, there's closed form solutions as an absorbing Markov chain to say, okay, what is the probability to get absorbed from each cell into each one of my terminal states? And again, you can use the graph structure to automatically infer these terminal states. And this is really just just matrix multiplication. You just power the matrix. And by powering this matrix, we can compute for each cell the probability of reaching each, you know, terminal fate. And I really think that, you know, yes, we math is great. You know, we have the equations here, but to really understand what's going on and also to get a better connection to your data and how math is working on your data, I love to visualize algorithms. I think it's very informative, and it teaches you, you know, what's going on, what the structure of your data here. So this is actually a subset of real hematopoiesis data. So it's a toy example of, you know, trimmed down hematopoiesis data so that we could actually look at it. But it's a subset of real data. And this is that first matrix where each edge in the graph is an entry in the matrix based on its weight. And you can see it's largely in the diagonal because the matrix is ordered by pseudo time and by cell similarity. So this is like, you know, the original graph translated to a matrix and where each cell can go, the nearest neighbors. But as I power this matrix five times, you could begin to see the structure. Every entry is really colored by its probability, and you begin to see some off-diagonal events of cells, you know, going a little bit farther away. You can sort of see where it's going. After 50 steps, you can see that cells spread with clear preferences in the graph. And, you know, we have the branch probability here on the right. So, you know, at 50 steps, you have some cells that are really probably, you know, will get to the absorbing state with almost, you know, high probability, cells that just can't make it to the terminal states in 50 steps and everything in between. And, you know, 500 steps, and again, there's a closed form solution to go over all possible paths of all possible lengths, giving you for each cell the probability to reach each terminal state. And if you look at the entropy on that, I view it as sort of plasticity or differential potential, you know, how uncertain that cell is, how plastic is it, you know, is it like dark yellow, you know, almost certain to reach the green fate? Or is it like this middle row right here, which is very, very high entropy, or the top row right here, where the probabilities are spread and we don't know which fate it will reach? And again, to visualize this, you know, this is the graph that created that same structure you saw. You know, a cell here at the top, earliest, the progenitor cell, has probabilities to reach everywhere. As we go down, you know, we still have probabilities to reach, but even as it seems to be going towards the blue probability, it has a lot, you could see there's a big plane here. It doesn't, there's no point. There's this big sort of triangle, and as it begins to choose between the blue and the green. And modeling this in a probabilistic manner really allows us to ask deep biological questions. So, again, this is work that we did collaboratively with my colleague here, Katajin Tanakis, who's a leading embryologist that studies early mammalian embryo development, and Sonia, who is, you know, one of the most gifted developmental biologists I know. And we collected data from the endoderm. This is the region that's going to give rise to all your internal organs, to the pancreas, to the liver, to the lungs, to the thyroid, and all these things. And we looked at the earliest stages of mouse embryo, right? You know, until it becomes a gut tube. At this point, all your internal organs are a single smooth tube. And we saw that the data really has a lot of structure. So what we could do with pseudo time And this is the first two time points, very, very early embryonic dates and the structure of the data. And this is the decision between embryonic and extra-embryonic. Embryonic is what's going to become our body, and extra-embryonic is going to go to yolk sac and placenta and all these other goodies to sort of protect the embryo. And you could see that actually the decisions of whether it's going to become embryonic or extra-embryonic happen a day before or previously. You know, you could already see at embryonic day three that it was either extra-embryonic or embryonic to the left. You could see the pseudo time, as well as the probability, really capturing the fact that it was already in day 3.5, a large portion of the cells already know their fate. The other nice thing is, because I have a pseudo time ordering, because I can arrange them along in order, I can see what genes, what signaling molecules, I have the probability to become extra-embryonic, to become primitive endoderm, and I can ask a simple question. What genes, what regulators best match and best predict and best sort of correlate with the probability of choosing the primitive endoderm fate? And when does this maximize? When does the cell actually really confirm and commit to this sort of extra-embryonic fate? And we really see that it's through the combinatorial action of two different genes, that no single gene or regulator gives it to you, but we could really see one of the reasons that they couldn't find this regulator using simplistic approaches as its combinatorial action of two. You need FGFR1 and 2 to be high to really lock this fate, and follow-up experiments really confirmed that this is indeed the case by knocking, by single and double knockouts. This was a prediction that was validated. Going one day forward, we actually find surprise. One of the things I love about biology and actually taking computational methods and using them for biological data analysis, and you always have to look at your data, because biology is always going to surprise you. And here, if you see here at day two, you see a very clear, distinct, separated split. The decision's been made. But actually, one day later, at day 5.5, we found this bridge right here. And, of course, our biology colleagues thought this is noise. But again, we have a lot of statistical tricks to see, is this noise or does it have a lot of structure? In biology, when I try and distinguish sort of noise from biology, biology is very structured. You can always find structure in the data, covariant structure. Things behave according to patterns. And noise is unstructured, and we have a lot of tests in our arsenal to sort of distinguish between structure and sort of random noise. Pseudotime really suggests that there's a high region of plasticity here. All these blue cells right here, they're pretty set on being embryonic, but suddenly at this edge right here, you see a high region of plasticity, a high region of high entropy. And indeed, if you look at the probabilities, the fate probabilities, we see a transdifferentiation suggested from epiblasts, from cells that had already decided to become embryonic to extra-embryonic endoderm. And the arrow predicts one way. Of course, it took a while to convince our colleagues to do this. And using two different lineage tracing methods, we could see that cells of epiblast origin, translocated to the membrane, changed their morphology, changed their markers, and developed both the markers and the morphology of extra-embryonic tissue. So we actually found this transdifferentiation. 2 days later, we actually have a transdifferentiation the other way of extra-embryonic cells entering the gut tube. In addition to pseudotime, one of the things we found is once the cell forms a gut tube, the most dominant signal in the data is not pseudotime, but actually pseudospace. And the cells, the biggest sort of component of variation in this data is actually pseudospace, matching the anterior head to posterior tail. And all the cells sort of organize into clusters that match the organs that will bud out of each of these locations. We could predict gene expression along this gut tube and what's going on. And our predictions were validated by staining. as I said, there's this, here you see a video of this happening. The green cells are of cells of extraembryonic origin. They get sucked physically, literally into the gut tube when the embryo just turns inside out to form this gut tube. And as you see in this cartoon, the gut tube is actually a mosaic of both embryonic and extraembryonic cells. And we wanted to know what happened to these extraembryonic cells who really had all these morphologies of, you know, a transcriptional of a protective membrane layer. What happens when they get sucked into the gut tube? And what we discovered is that cells are incredibly plastic. And even though they were sort of on their way to become extraembryonic, on their way to becoming a yolk sac and not even part of the body, they sort of could look around and see, oh, my neighbors are giving me signals to become progenitors of thymus. My neighbors are giving me signals to become progenitors of liver. And relative to this pseudo time, the extraembryonic and embryonic cells reach more than 99% transcriptional identity, including expressing all the master regulators of each lineage. So, you know, that was a real powerful thing that we could do once we had an accurate algorithm. This type of analysis wouldn't have been possible without really putting a lot of effort to developing an algorithm that gets both pseudo time accurately, that gets lineage probabilities accurately, that can handle rare populations, and, you know, get pseudo space accurately, as well as, you know, do a lot of tests for distinguishing noise from signal and a lot of other things along the way. Now, this framework that I showed you, this basically Markov chain framework to study trajectories and development, is actually really flexible. We can define what features we're using to define the similarity. So I started similarity metric. There's so many different ways to define similarity metric, including using epigenetics and open chromatin instead of gene expression or protein expression or imaging morphology. So we can actually replace the features that we're looking at in the similarity metric. And the other thing that we need to figure out, so one is the similarity metric, the connectivity of the graph. And the other thing that we can play around with is how we orient the edges. Pseudo time makes a very strong assumption that more immature cells, are precede more mature cells, that direction, that trajectories go from less mature to more mature. It's a very strong assumption, which is broken in things such as regeneration and cancer. So really, we can try and orient edges using other sources of information. And I'll show you examples of that. So here's a quick example by Prisca Liberali, where she's using, you know, our same approach, same graph approach, our algorithm, and she just replaced the gene expression with features based on these organoids morphology. She could get a pseudo time and branching probabilities and everything and predict regulators that choose where these organoids bud. In these gut organoids and the same approach, the same algorithm, the same core Markov chain principles really can find, you know, when you give it images and morphology of these images can find regulators of budding and morphogenesis. So it's a very powerful approach. I'm actually going to go into to really orienting it because, you know, actually finding the directionality and directing this Markov chain and saying what direction, what are the, you know, early fates, what are the future fates, what direction are these cells going is one of the hardest problems here. And this pseudo time approach is certainly, you know, inappropriate for regeneration in cancer. A little while ago, out of Peter Karchenko's and Sten Lenarsson's lab, there was this really cool concept of RNA velocity. You know, everyone was very excited. And the idea is that you could look at the unspliced reads and look at the ratio between an unspliced reads and the spliced reads of a gene and figure out, you know, is this gene being made? When there's more unspliced reads than spliced reads, it's being transcribed, spliced, and the assumption is that its transcription is rising. And when they're more spliced than unspliced, you know, it's degrading, the transcription has finished, and it's post-peak. Now, this is an imperfect approach, but I think it's a really beautiful algorithm, and again, a wonderful lesson for anyone in computational biology. And the reason that this is so beautiful is that at the time, they basically said, let's look in the garbage bin. You know, all algorithms take these unspliced reads and throw them in the garbage and ignore them. Let's look in the garbage bin and get more information from the garbage bin by looking at the unspliced to spliced ratio. Beautiful idea. It works really great in anything neuro related, because neuro related has tons of introns and tons of splicing. But you know, even for neuro, if you sort of zoom in, you see that these beautiful smooth velocity vectors you see on any publication, if you look at velocity papers, if you look at the individual cells, a lot of them have low degree of certainty. Here, the length of the arrow is the certainty. So you see a few certain arrows, but many uncertain arrows. And you see arrows in a similar region pointing in different directions. So this is too noisy for us. So we decided that, and this is collaboration with Fabian Thais and led by Marius, who came to visit in my lab last, you know, pre-pandemic. He came right before such lab visits were impossible, but he spent a good 8 months in New York. And the idea was, let's sort of marry the best of both worlds, Palantir, to really adhere to the manifold and velocity to really get the high the directionality in high dimensional space. So here's our manifold, sort of visualized in 3D, and this is sort of a cartoon of pancreatic development. For each cell, you know, there's the velocity vector, the direction that velocity predicts that it's going, but there's also the neighbor graph, cell states that are possible in the region of the manifold. And basically, cell rank says, we're going to actually, one, do some global, we're going to use all the features of this global manifold learning, and we're going to force the velocities to remain within the manifold. You can't have a velocity pointing in a direction where there's no cell states possible. But we're going to use the velocity to say which direction is more possible. And we're actually going to use the cosine similarity to say cells that are aligned, you know, neighbors that are aligned in the general direction of the velocity vector have a much higher probability than cells that are going the other way. So, you know, we weigh in the direction of the velocity, we weigh in the cell-cell similarity, but we limit it all to remain within the cell phenotypic manifold. And so here we really keep our computation within the manifold. Velocities, you know, you can go to cell states that are possible, and, you know, you can propagate and do the sort all the Markov chain math in order to really get global properties from these very tiny, local, and noisy velocities. Cell rank, other than using absorbance probabilities, also really ups and improves the way that we compute these long-range probabilities using, you know, some fancier math. Again, as I said, the theory here is really great. And we take coarse grain, you know, we take these noisy little transition graphs, and you could see that there is structure here. We use clustering to actually coarse grain the noisy local dynamics and to find the main metastable states. And this allows us to find automatically the initial, intermediate, and terminal stable states, and, you know, do everything that we could do with Palantir, but now infused with some velocity direction. We could also take the uncertainty directly into account. With velocity, we know if the cell is certain or uncertain. And so, you know, we actually, you know, how much we're going to sort of force the probability, how much weight we're going to put on following the velocity direction is really controlled by how certain we are of this velocity. So in different cells, depending on the certainty of the velocity, we upweigh or downweigh the velocity, again, propagate the certainty globally. And so, you know, just to sort of benchmark it, here we're using cell tagging, which gives us a ground truth. You know, so different cells are tagged, and we can sort of look at their progenitors into the future based on their tag. Now, if you look at velocity, success is right here up here, and you can see that there's actually no edges leading into success based on, you know, velocity streams, and in fact, all the velocities leave the success state, which is supposed to be a terminal state, and you know, also, most seems to be streaming towards the dead end, which again doesn't look like a terminal state. So this sort of 2D embedding of short range velocity really doesn't cut it. you know, when you try and do stuff, it really gives you garbage. But, you know, cell rank can really, really predict quite accurately based on the ground truth cell tagging labels, which it didn't use. And of course, its accuracy improves as you get closer to the end. So the accuracy at day 12 is not nearly as good as the accuracy at day 21. The final success or dead end is measured at day 25. This is all great, and we were really happy with our accuracy, especially given that, you know, velocity miserably failed here, and we could correct that. But in vitro is always very simple. You know, Bethesda, there's a whole slew, you know, endless methods that work in vitro data, which just has completely different statistical nature, completely simpler structure and behavior than in vivo. And there's methods that you know, are just beautiful and perfect and everything in vitro, but just, you know, crash and fail in vivo. So we wanted to test this in an in vivo system. And so we wanted to ask a lot of questions. Again, these velocity vectors alone are just insufficient to answer, like, you know, how do you get to this purple fate right here? What are the probabilities of, you know, it seems like everything, you know, if you look at these cells in the orange, early orange, you have no idea where they're going to end up, the green or the blue or whatnot. And so, again, we found this purple cell, this tiny purple population, one of the more challenging ones. So we said, okay, so we actually, again, the advantage of using well-studied systems, we could look at these sort of progenitor populations clustered right here. These are progenitors, which biologically we know where they're going due to fate mapping and due to all sorts of genetic experiments over decades. And we could see that these brown cells, which, you know, through prior knowledge, we know are going to become the delta state. Cell rank actually says these are the cells that are going to become the delta fate. And again, the probability to become delta based on cell rank versus the probability to become delta based on what we know from prior biology is really very distinct, as you can see here. And again, the power is we could look at the regulators that rise and fall and pick up both the canonical regulators of the delta fate as well as additional regulators. And in fact, you know, looking at these probabilities to go towards each fate and weighting sort of these gene trends based on the probability to become one fate or another, we could pick up all the known master regulators of each fate as the strongest regulator driving that fate. I said that, you know, the true test is regeneration, or standard pseudotime approaches is going to fail. And one of the things that cell rank predicted is basal states, which are very, very goblet cells here, which are mature cells, go towards basal state, which are primitive cells. So this is going the complete other direction of the Palantir. Palantir would say basal, early progenitor would become goblet. And here we're saying, no, the goblet becomes basal. And in fact, there is no direct trajectory from basal to goblet known. The path is basal to club to goblet. So this was, again, a very weird prediction. But the signal was very strong. Before we sent any biologist to the lab, we sort of really check our, you know, that the signal is strong and reproducible and robust. You know, we went to the lab and indeed showed that again, cell rank's prediction of goblet to basal through no other intermediate was true. And, you know, cell rank is very modular, so we can have, you know, the kernel for the similarity metric and for the, you know, build the directionality, the probability of going from one cell to another, as well as the estimators that sort of estimate and do sort of global computations on this very, very, very large graph slash matrix. Here's a quick example when we use early zebrafish development, where velocities are miserable. Everything is wrong using velocity. The reason is, again, there's almost no unspliced counts here, so this made the data really challenging. Here we're sort of using cytotrace, which basically says, you know, finds the genes that are meaningful, and, you know, using this kernel, we get it right. Another quick direction, I see I'm running out of time, so I'm going to run a bit quicker, but I tried to go slow through this foundation. Velocity fails for hematopoiesis. Here there's enough unspliced reads, but none of the unspliced reads fall in the master regulators of this lineage. So even though we have a lot of unspliced reads, they're not in the genes where the biology is happening. They're not in the genes that sort of drive the structure and the decision making. Here we're using attack. Basically, we're going to use attack to predict future cell fates, and the idea is we can learn a function of where a cell is going to go based on its open chromatin and transcription factors. We learn a linear function because even though regulation is not linear, it's just so much more robust when you're trying to do something global. And basically, we want to build a genome-wide model. Once we have this genome-wide model, we can really predict the current state, extrapolate future states from the current state given the model, and build velocities based on regulatory information. Of course, we have to learn both the structure, which TFs regulate which targets. That's where the attack and open chromatin and motifs are going to help her. And we're going to really constrain the regulators based on the TFs in this chromatin, as well as how this regulation happened, the magnitudes, the effect. Once we have the structure, what are the parameters? These are a lot of unknown parameters. So we learn this through expectation maximization. When you have too many unknowns, for it to succeed, you need a good starting point and good constraints. There was a lot of engineering here to get it to work. But as you could see, it works for hematopoiesis. And not only do we sort of get the correct velocities, but we really get the correct structure. One of the reasons I like working with regulatory models is because you can really get predictions. You can understand why something is happening. So we could ask, okay, what regulators are really driving this? What regulators, if I perturb them, so, you know, I can make a prediction. What happens if I knock out a regulator? I'd want to knock out a regulator that really changes the direction of the velocity vector. So if I knock down a regulator, the cell will go in a completely different direction. That means that's a regulator that was really important for cell fate and cell fate decisions. And this importance score based that we find really predicts the important regulators for each one of these cell fate decisions automatically. Number of binding sites doesn't cut it. It works sometimes. Sometimes it miserably failed. Mean expression doesn't work. But this importance score of how much is our regulatory model perturbed, how much is the regulatory velocity, how much is the future direction of the cell, you know, shifted, it really picks up all known regulators of hematopoiesis quite accurately. So in summary, you know, I tried to sort of run through a decade of research, but really along a common theme that the asynchrony in single cell data really allows you to reveal a continuum of cell types. You could learn dynamics and regulation from this continuum. Modeling these things with nearest neighbor graphs and then, you know, the power of Markov chains and you know, representing these neighbor graphs as matrices with all the math that comes with all the eigen decompositions and everything that you can do is really powerful. It's a very modular approach. So the way you build a graph, the similarity metric, the how you direct it can really give you a lot of applications. Splicing velocity is one powerful approach for directionality. Attack is an even more powerful modality that even gives you the causal regulatory factors from underneath. And cancer is still particularly challenging, and we have a lot more methods development to do before I'm really happy with how well these methods actually work in the cancer scenarios that I worked so hard at MSKCC. Finally, you know, I showed you only a small sliver of the work in my lab, and it's really spearheaded by Cassandra and Manu Manu is no longer in my lab, Marius and Fabian's lab, and some great collaborations, and thank you so much for your attention.